Hello, my name is Richard Foy. I'm the regional director for EXIM Bank in the Northeast region. Today, we're going to discuss Incoterms. First, imagine bringing together a group of international business people discussing shipping for trade. Imagine all the complexities that this involves. Well, to simplify the process, one needs a common language to cover liabilities, risks, and responsibilities. We're going to cover these elements today. Incoterms explain a set of 11 of the most commonly used three-letter terms, such as FOB, CIF, DAP, so on. Reflecting business-to-business practice in contracts of sale for the purchase of goods. They're published by the International Chamber of Commerce in Paris, and the rules define the conditions of the supply of goods in international sales transactions. The first version was in 1936, and they've been updated through the years to the one currently in force, which is Incoterms 2020. The breakup of Incoterms is international commerce terms. Incoterms define the mutual obligations of the seller and the buyer arising from the movement of goods under international contract from the standpoint of risk, cost, and documents. They're designed for international trade, but you see more and more use in domestic shipping as well. They're not used for services. And again, it's designed to be a common language to understand the responsibilities as they relate to shipping. It's important to understand that Incoterms are private law rules, and they're not supported by the laws of any country or a supranational organization. They're rules set by businesses within the ICC in order to regulate some aspects of foreign trade operations. Incoterms do not have the force of law, and therefore one is not obligated to use them in international trade operations. However, their use will be conditioned on the acceptance of parties in the sales contract. And once they're made part of the contract, the laws take over from there. So they would be considered part of a contract and legally obligated to commit to. Incoterms are broken up into three basic components. Three criteria are obligations. So this is who does what as between the seller and the buyer, who organizes carriage or insurance of the goods, and who obtains shipping documents and export or import licenses. The next is cost. Which party is responsible for which cost? For example, transport, packaging, loading or unloading, and security related costs. And finally, risk. This is where and when the seller delivers the goods. In other words, where the risk transfers from the seller to the buyer. First criterion is the mode of transport used. In the version 2020, there are 7 Incoterms that can be used with any mode of transport, surface, air, or sea, or multimodal. While there are 4 Incoterms that can be used only with sea transport and inland waterways, canals, rivers, and lakes. You can see those below, but we'll go into greater detail in a little while. The second criterion for classification is the payment of the main transport, which is the international transport between the country of origin and the country of destination. The Incoterms distinguish between those terms in which the main transport payment is made by the buyer, the importer, and those where it's made by the seller, the exporter. And finally, the transfer of risk. We should distinguish between those Incoterms in which the obligation to deliver the goods by the seller, and therefore the transfer of risk in transport, occurs at the country of origin, while in other terms, the obligations of delivery occurs in the country of destination. You can see these below. Now, it's important to understand that we can slice these terms and group them in many different ways, like we just did. Transport, payment, and risk, you can identify them there. And we'll go into some other ways that you can organize them. Here you can see 4 groups, C, D, E, and F. And you can see C terms have a high commitment level on the from the seller. And E term has very little commitment from the seller. I prefer to identify them a different way because I work with sellers mainly, with Export Import Bank. We work with exporters. So I tend to concentrate on the risk of the seller. If you're working with buyers, you may look at it a different way. I like to look at it this way, EFCD. So E, we're looking at the risk stops at export. So E terms, the seller makes the goods available to the buyer at the delivery point indicated by the seller. So the seller's in control in the, at this point. The seller is not obligated to perform any customs or export clearance and does not bear the risk and cost of loading. So that's important. They have virtually no no risk and no cost for the international transfer. F, an F term, the seller is responsible for the export customs clearance, but they're not responsible to pay for transportation or insurance costs. And C, now C, the seller is getting more into some responsibilities. They're responsible for export customs clearance. The seller also arranges for the transport contract with the forwarder or carrier. But all costs after the loading are the responsibility of the buyer. So at air freight, this is when it's delivered to the carrier. Ocean freight would be when it's on board the vessel. And D, the seller assumes the most responsibility. They're obligated to deliver the goods to a specific place on the buyer's side after the port, after the port of destination. So E, again, the buyer is responsible for collecting the goods at the seller's warehouse. There's only one term in the E grouping. This is X works. It's applicable to any mode of transport. And you can see the payment of a main transport is the responsibility of the buyer and the transfer of risk occurs in origin. So this offers the least control, but also the least risk for the seller. In the F term, the seller is responsible for bringing the goods to the buyer's predefined transport medium. There are three terms here, one of which, free carrier, FCA, is for any mode. The buyer is responsible for the payment of transport and the risk transfers at origin. FAS, free alongside ship, is very much a C term, and free on board, also a C term, but they have the same basic meanings, meaning the payment is borne by the buyer and the risk transfers at origin. C terms are interesting. The seller bears all the costs to the destination point. They arrange for the transport, but they don't have to pay for the main transport. We have two terms, carriage paid to, and you identify at where it's paid to in the term. CIP, carriage and insurance paid to. So you have basically where you are responsible for insurance and where you're not responsible for the insurance. This is applicable for any mode. Seller is responsible for payment of the transport, but the risk occurs at origin. CFR, cost and freight, and CIF, cost, insurance and freight, are two C terms, or CSEA, as in vessel. But they essentially have the same meaning. So CIP and CIF require the seller to contract for insurance against the buyer's risk of loss or damage. I used to caution buyers on this term because the obligation for the seller to obtain limited named peril coverage was Institute Cargo Clause C. This is a named peril coverage, like I said. Incoterms 2020 modifies this rule and requires them to place all risk coverage. So it's safer now for a buyer and seller to use this with it without fully understanding the cargo clauses. Keep in mind though, some countries require insurance coverage to be purchased locally. In this case, the party should consider selling on CPT terms rather than a CIP where you're responsible for the insurance. And D, this is this you have the most responsibility as the seller because you are obligated to purchase the insurance, in some cases, deliver the goods, and you're responsible for the risk the entire journey until they are at the named place. Here you can see the difference between Ex Works, and we just went through these, Ex Works, where the buyer pays for the transport and the risk transfers at origin, to DDP, where the seller is responsible for the cost, and they also accept the risk responsibility through the entire journey. Exporters should exercise caution when using these terms, as they must ensure that they have the ability to obtain all the necessary export documentation for a complete and accurate file. Now, we'll go over why FCA is less risky than it used to be in a little while. But I would, whenever the risk is transferring and you have no control over the transport, you are accepting a certain risks, even though it looks on the surface that you are getting rid of the risk. For example, if you have an EXIM insurance policy and you have a claim, you've not been paid, you're going to be responsible to deliver all of the necessary documentation, which would include bills of lading and any other acceptance documents. If you're not able to provide those because you don't have a relationship with the carrier, you haven't contracted for the freight, this could pose a problem. And poor documentation is one of the main reasons why claims are denied, unfortunately. So I always encourage you to exercise caution using these terms. I want to touch on some changes that have occurred in the latest version of Incoterms, which is 2020. DAT has changed to DPU. DPU, so it's duty paid unloaded, delivered paid unloaded, is the only term that requires a seller to unload the goods. This requires a great deal of coordination and should be thoughtfully considered prior to accepting. Insurance points are now clarified in CIF and CIP Incoterm rules. Cost and cost structures are now clarified. I think that's a big change that's very meaningful. Security in relation to the transport is now clearly detailed. And provisions to allow for the own transport rather than assuming third-party transport is also included in the new version. And FCA, as stated, now is FOB and the bill of lading. We'll touch on that shortly. Overall, though, I think the presentation and design is much more user-friendly in the latest version. So the DAT rule, delivered at terminal, has been renamed to delivered at place unloaded. This name change underlines the fact that delivery can happen anywhere and not just at a terminal. This is where folks would look at things and they say, well, this is a good term, DAT. However, we have these circumstances. And over the years, they've had to modify these. And it doesn't generally work out well. As with DAT, the only rule that requires a seller to unload the goods at destination is now DPU. Freight insurance for the CIP rule is the level of cover required. Unless otherwise specified, you can modify these in the sales contract, keep in mind. The Institute Cargo Clause A is a higher level cover than specified in the 2010 version, where it was the Institute Cargo Clause C. That was a named peril coverage, C. A is all risk coverage, and I'll say that in quotes, all risk. For the CIF rule, there's been no change. The default level of cover remains at the C level. And the reasoning is CIF is generally used for commodities transactions where the lower level cover is more appropriate and widely accepted. And like I said, keep in mind, restrictions or enhancements can be made a part of the contract. So you can have a term, but then CIP, but then further limit the coverage or, you know, add in some conditions for that coverage. Also, I want to note that, well, the institute clause will say all risk coverage. That does not necessarily mean that everything is covered. So one should be fully informed when making these decisions. Understand what is being covered, what's not being covered, and if what's not being covered is important to you, then you should take steps to further mitigate that risk. This is a big change that I think is important. FCA and bills of lading. According to FCA, now the buyer must contract or arrange at its own cost for the carriage of goods. So there's a gap between FCA, which is free carrier. So your obligation under this term is to deliver it to the carrier, and FOB, where it's actually on board the vessel. You're responsible and you're at risk for the loading. In 2010, Incoterms, exporters of goods and containers were encouraged to use FCA. That made sense. However, many people were using FOB because when they should have been using FCA. They wanted to use FOB as a shipper because standard letter of credit language requires an onboard bill of lading to be presented. Therefore, the sellers were often taking the additional risk and cost using FOB because they wanted to get paid under the letter of credit, which makes sense. And since they were not in control of the cargo, they weren't contracting for the cargo, the carrier wasn't obligated to give them a bill of lading. So Incoterms 2020 FCA now states that if the parties have so agreed, which they should, the buyer must instruct the carrier to issue the seller at the buyer's cost and risk a transport document stating that the goods have been loaded, such as a bill of lading with an onboard notation. Now, in red here, we see how the Incoterms should be written into a contract. FCA, and you identify the named place of delivery, and you must identify Incoterms 2020. Now, by default, if you don't state what Incoterm, it's known that it's the latest version. But I still recommend identifying the specific version you're talking about. In this case, Incoterms 2020. The listing of costs. All of costs now are listed in the allocation of costs section for each rule. Each rule has an A and a B section. So sellers' cost and risk responsibilities, and B, the buyer's responsibilities. So, and they're numbered. Because of the ordering and the articles, the rules have changed. So now it's covered. These listing of costs are covered in A9 and B9 section. Costs were a big issue in the 2010 version. Carriers often changed their pricing structure to look more attractive up front. And then the add-ons were often billed to the seller in back charges, and they weren't necessarily prepared for that. They haven't priced it. So these were a problem. The A9 section in Incoterm now collects together the cost with the principal aim of clearly stating the cost and responsibilities for each party. I think they've done a really good job of that. Cargo security, of course, any exporter will tell you this has been an increasing concern, certainly since 9/11. But since the last revision of Incoterms 2010, the geopolitical backdrop against which international trade is conducted has changed significantly. With that in mind, the ICC has expanded the security-related requirements, and there are new provisions allocated to allocate responsibility between the seller and the buyer. All right, so we've kind of touched a lot on what's covered, what Incoterms are meant to deal with. I feel it's important to just identify things that are not covered and often misunderstood by exporters and importers alike. They assume things are included in the use of Incoterms, but they're not. One of which is payment of goods. It seems logical, but there are many options in this area as to when and how payment is made. And it's an important point of negotiation, irrespective of the Incoterm. One must be sensitive not to create an Incoterm and a payment term that causes conflict and exposure without means of mitigation. An example would be when responsibility and liability pass to an importer, where credit terms have been extended, such as FOB, SCA, port of export sale, when you've extended 60-day payment terms. Now, you have a risk of payment, right? But you've shed the control of the cargo and you've shed the risk responsibility at origin. So in those cases, what would happen if the ship was lost or damaged? Likely, the buyer would refuse to pay you because they've never received it. And if they've not insured the goods themselves and don't have the means to be made whole, you're going to be left holding the bag. So the question arises, do you have insurable interest? So you have to look at the contract and see how you've written the contract. When does title transfer? If you still hold title, you have insurable interest and you should be insuring those goods. That's one way to cover that. So these are two examples, FCA, FOB, where, again, you have little control, but you certainly have risk of payment if extended terms. I want to break down Ex-Works because many sellers, certainly new to export, and I work in the small business group within the bank, so I deal with a lot of companies that are new to export and their idea, because many times this is, I'll say, an accidental export where they've maybe been at a trade show, an opportunity has come up, and they're not used to exporting. They haven't really thought the process out completely. So they say, all right, well, I know there's a lot of risk associated with export. Let's choose an Incoterm that relieves me of most responsibility. Okay, makes sense. So again, Ex-Works, we've gone over this. Seller has to provide the goods and the commercial invoice conforming with the contract. There are delivery responsibilities, so to make the goods available to the buyer at an agreed point. Generally, this would be the seller's warehouse. The risk transfer, as soon as you make the goods available to the buyer. The seller has no obligation to the buyer for the carriage, the insurance, or delivery. So it seems like a home run. However, with limited obligations, you have limited control. So let's break it down further. If the seller is loading the cargo, now it's not the responsibility under this term to load the cargo. It's to be made available at a place. Again, generally their warehouse. But if it's at your warehouse, you likely have the means to load the truck, let's just say it is. So now that you've accepted that responsibility to load the truck because you have the tools, a forklift, what happens when it's damaged? Well, now you've extended your exposure, right? Not under the term, but practically, you've agreed to handle the cargo. And if it's damaged to the seller, if it's damaged, the seller would be responsible, unless you clearly spell that out in the contract, which you can do. Not responsible for loading. The risk transfer, again, you're expanding that into the loading risk. The carriage, the seller has no responsibility to the buyer for choosing or paying for the cargo, but the seller needs a documentation to complete their file, right? And in an Ex-Works term, you're likely not going to have that control. And that could impact you later on, as we said with a claim against non-payment. Insurance, While again, they have the seller has no obligation to furnish insurance, it might be in their best interest to obtain it for themselves. And delivery, again, they have no obligation to have the goods delivered, but it's a good idea to require a delivery receipt. This will, again, help you complete your file in case you have to claim against either your cargo insurance carrier or your credit insurance carrier. And another important issue to consider is freight and ancillary expenses, which do pop up. While the freight payment should coincide with the selected Incoterm, important issues such as being prepaid or collect can have a bearing on the overall financial impact. And this is addressed more in the new version, but again, you should know exactly, you should read these terms and understand what is covered or what you're responsible for as a seller and what the buyer is responsible for. Examples are demurrage and other ancillary freight expenses. They can be made an issue when not spelled out clearly in the contract of sale. And I gave you an example early on where there would be chargebacks from the carrier and the seller was unaware that these would be coming back. So they didn't price their goods appropriately. So as I said, you know, they tried to make that modification in new version. I think they did a pretty good idea, a pretty good job, but you should review it nonetheless. So insurance is another one. We've gone through this already as far as you should still probably look as a seller to insure the goods. You know, it's really important to look at every area of risk within the transaction and try to mitigate those risks. Some exposures are, you know, payment, physical loss or damage, as well as products liability that's often overlooked. But this is a key element that folks often overlook, and I've been in the insurance business for a long time, cargo insurance. And even cargo insurance underwriters misunderstand this aspect of Incoterms. Title is not determined by the Incoterm. It is determined by the sales contract. It's got to be spelled out in the sales contract or the agreement or even what the exporter has on the commercial invoice. Title should only pass on an export once the contract has been satisfied, meaning the exporter has delivered the goods and the importer has paid for the goods. This needs to be expressly written into a contract of sale or on the commercial invoice. In the book, in the Incoterms prologue, the ICC has specifically stated, quote, perhaps most importantly, it must be stressed that the Incoterm rules do not deal with the transfer of property, title, ownership of the goods sold. It's very important. And I think, you know, the final important issue that I want to go over is trade compliance management. It's a very important byproduct of all this, but it's a necessary component in best practices initiative and to meet the government guidelines, which include due diligence, reasonable care, supervision, and control in their global supply chains. In the U.S., we have USPPI concern. This is the United States principal party in interest. This entity is the company that receives the primary benefit in an export transaction and is responsible for export compliance. This would be the information passed on to the government where the goods are shipped, how they're going to, who they're going to, and how they'll be utilized. The government doesn't care if the Incoterms are Ex-Works, FOB, FCA, whatever. They'll still hold the manufacturer responsible for trade compliance. So this begs the question, why would a company allow a third party not under their control to handle the shipment? This creates significant compliance exposures, and these must be factored in when deciding which Incoterm to utilize. So I want to stress to utilize Incoterms for their intended purpose. Their intended purpose, going back to the beginning, is to provide uniformity in identifying the basic roles and responsibilities of the seller and the buyer as they relate to delivery risk in the transportation of goods. Avoid depending on them for things beyond their intended purpose, such as transfer of title, the time, place, method, or even currency of payment. And avoid assuming that all risks have been transferred to the buyer, because you retain a significant amount of risk, even though the risk for transportation has been pushed onto the buyer. And ensure the contract of sale clearly spells out all commercial aspects of the transaction, as well as their remedies. I just want to point you to some resources. I recommend you look into the National Customs Brokers and Freight Forwarders Association. This is a member-based group that provides a wealth of learning resources, as well as member contracts, like freight forwarders and attorneys, brokers as well. Developing a relationship with a quality freight forwarder and attorney can take a lot of the headache out of your export transactions. Members are well experienced and can provide insight in the application of Incoterms. Also, contact your local port authority. I've listed here, the National Port Authority, aapa-ports.org. They're an excellent resource to get you into your local port authority or wherever you're going to be doing business. They're a great resource. And that is it for me. This way I can properly thank you on my slide. I appreciate you taking the time. I hope this was informative for you. We're going to take some questions and we're ready.
Thank you, Richard. We have a number of great questions about your presentation. First question, are the Incoterms rules relevant to domestic transactions?
Sure. The use of the rules are not limited to cross-border trading. They're applicable to really any transactions where the buyer and seller need to establish some conformity. All the provisions of the rule are written with this in mind. So there are issues related to import duties and taxes that may not be applicable, but the overall theme can be used on domestic transactions.
Excellent, Richard. Next question, how are the Incoterms rules relevant to transfer of title to the goods?
Well, they're kind of not. This should absolutely be dealt with elsewhere in the commercial agreement. Title is not not something dealt with. What often happens, though, or I guess historically, documentation would be held by the seller. That documentation controlled the release of cargo, so an onboard bill of lading. Would control those. So you would have original documents that would be handed over to the buyer once payment was received. So there was that control. Now with express bills of lading and air freight, these things change quite a bit. So many people got confused thinking that Incoterm controlled the title, but it absolutely does not.
Next question, Richard, pertains to cargo security costs. The question is, what do the Incoterms rules say about costs for cargo security?
Well, they do discuss in that A9 area, specifically where costs are borne by the buyer or the seller. Obviously, this has been an increased area of importance in the transport of goods. So it's really important to look at that section of whatever rule you're looking to apply to your contract.
The next question is, can we add qualifications or variations to a rule?
Sure. But I would exercise caution. It's possible to add extra words to an Incoterm rule, so to cater to specific situations. But keep in mind, these are this is controlled language. So if you use an Incoterm, it's set, there's a very clear definition for it. Some examples of how you can further a specific term, maybe costs arise from the stowing of cargo. So you can say FOB stowed to make it clearer as to, you know, what you're taking responsibility for. Another would be DDP VAT, value-added tax, unpaid. So just to clarify that you're going to pay as a seller for the duty, but you're not paying for that value-added tax. But as I was saying, you know, I would caution you, by qualifying the rule, there's a danger of increasing or introducing ambiguity to the rule. So if you are saying X works unloaded, well, who is bearing the cost for that? You could argue that particular point. So I always caution modifying the rules, but they can be done.
Looks like we have time for one more question, Richard. The question is, what do the rules say about cargo insurance?
So there are rules that have specific provisions, CIF and CIP rules, for example, deal with cargo insurance. In both cases, the seller is required to buy cargo insurance for the portion of the journey where the seller is off risk. And once the goods have been delivered to the carrier, that insurance, where it is identified in the Incoterm, is for the benefit of the buyer, who must claim from the insurer if necessary, if there's damage. And that's for, you know, loss of you know, loss or damage to the cargo, for the physical loss or damage. So that was the last question, right? You said we had, yeah. Just want to thank everybody, you know, for tuning into that, and make a point that, well, a couple of points. Just to, one, the slides will be made available for everybody. We'll include that in however we're sending those slides out. And two, you know, enjoy the rest of the conference. I know we have a really packed schedule for you, and with a lot of great content and great speakers. So thanks for tuning in.